Monday, and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad Vries, and this is the weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
Oh, hi there, Collider TV Talk. It's me, Josh Macuga, here on a Monday, just getting ready to bring you all the hits. Nothing but the hits on a big Monday night football here on Collider TV Talk, which is excited to talk about everything. We got Ghostrider images. We got the Knicks. We got so many pilots we're about to talk about. We're obviously going to break down Atlanta. Wait till we get to high to lows. We get all the things going on. Guys, we're coming into some busy, busy TV season. So you're in the thick of it. Get ready. Who else is here, Sinéad?
Also here is Sasha Perl-Raver.
I just want to send this one out to you, Kathy. I missed you last week too, girl. This one's for you. We are going to get bloody today. I'm telling you right now, Josh and I have already had words behind the scenes, and I've been singing. It's going to be vicissitudes, ups, downs. It's going to be a big one.
Buckle up. Buckle up.
There might be blood, and I'm definitely drinking someone's milkshake.
Sinéad. All right, and here to keep them in check is David Griffin.
I'm not really sure how to follow
I don't
that
know.
One,
there's no hat when the hat is off.
I went hatless today. Macuga's wearing my hat.
What's up?
Macuga's wearing my hat.
Ridiculous.
So last week, Sasha was funny. So I guess somebody had confused our laughs. I guess somebody thought, like, you know, I had my little cackle. I think they thought that was you. And they're like, I thought that was Sasha always doing that laugh. I guess it's David.
Yeah.
Yeah. People confused our laughs.
I think they just put foiled.
It was a big topic in the conversation.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
All right, Sinéad, let's kick this bad boy off. What is foist?
All right. Vince Gilligan and Michelle Maclaren, who worked together on Breaking Bad, are reuniting for an HBO miniseries based on the infamous cult leader Jim Jones, who led the followers of his People's Temple to mass suicide in Jonestown, Guyana. Gilligan will write the miniseries and Maclaren will direct, as well as executive produce, alongside Octavia Spencer, who optioned the rights to the source material 4 years ago for Sony Pictures TV. Spencer is not expected to act in the project. The series is based on the nonfiction book Raven, the untold story of the Reverend Jim Jones and his people by Tim Reiterman, a journalist who survived the events in Guyana. Josh, first the Branch Davidians and now Jonestown. What is next?
Well, we've got that. Remember the cult that killed themselves when that comet came? Remember when Hale bopped that comet?
Yeah.
And they like all drank, or they castrated themselves, and then they all killed themselves in like some weird part of the country. I would imagine we're going to get a miniseries out of that. But this, the Jonestown thing, there's an amazing ESPN 30 for 30 short about one of Jim Jones's sons actually played on a basketball team. And the basketball team just so happened to be in an away game at the same time that all of them drank the cyanide. For those of you guys that don't know what happened to Jonestown, do a little research. It's an amazing, weird part of American culture. This guy led all these people in this cult. They went to Guyana, built this community, and then he convinced all of them that they would go to heaven if they drank this cyanide poisoning. Talking about women, children as young as
you can hear the audio recordings.
The audio recording.
People screaming.
Yeah. People screaming.
And if like you ever hear somebody say like "don't drink the" or "you drank the Kool-Aid," and it that's what they're talking about because the cyanide was in Kool-Aid.
Yeah. You know what we'll get out of this, and hopefully, because I'm guessing the book really dives into it. This guy who survived it. Anyway, there's a documentary on ESPN about his son. They were at an away basketball game, and they all came back, and they were like, "Holy geez, everybody's dead. We're the only living people." This Jonestown thing, and they were separated across the world. Anyway, this is a really, really dark topic, and I think Vince Gilligan, you know, who's doing Better Call Saul, who obviously killed it in Breaking Bad. I'm super looking forward to this. This has like that dark, gritty kind of True Detective thing. If Vince Gilligan brings that same kind of shooting style. I don't know if he's going to do that in every show he does, but if he does something similar, I would be really, really excited to see something like that. David, you?
I'm really excited because I wanted to know what Vince Gilligan's next project was going to be, and of course, it's Better Call Saul, but Better Call Saul is still part of that Breaking Bad universe, so now this is stepping away from that. It's going to be a tough subject. This is a horrific. I mean, if you listen to those tapes, those screams will stay with you for a very long time. Yeah. I can still remember hearing those. I mean, it's something that it's just tough to watch and listen to, but I'm glad that they're going to tackle this issue. Yeah. And I'm glad it's Vince Gilligan. Michelle Maclaren, I was hoping she was going to do the Wonder Woman movie. That obviously didn't work out, but she's one of my favorite directors from that series. So this is a great team. This is going to be
solid.
And it's HBO.
It's
HBO. So.
It's interesting, too, that it's Octavia Spencer who brought this, that she had the source material, wants to get more into the producing side, which I think is really interesting. I mean, if Michelle brings anything close to as dramatic as that photo that we're we're using of her, like the cape up around her neck. It's very dynamic and dramatic.
That is a nice high necked.
There was an interesting, it's so much drama.
Keeps you warm.
But there was the Hollywood Reporter had a rundown of like what's hot right now, and it's true crime, true life, like JonBenet Ramsey. There's like four or five different versions of the JonBenet Ramsey.
Well, they had the
A&E
thing, and there's like a 60 Minutes thing.
There's also a Lifetime thing, and then of course you've got American Crime Story, and then you've just got American Crime, and this is really like the thing right now. This is what we're seeing such a major push toward. But the pedigree on this for me is the most exciting. I cannot wait to see what they do. I love the way Maclaren shoots. I think this will be absolutely fascinating, and I am very intrigued to see what Octavia Spencer brings on a producer side.
There's also another, I mean, even though it doesn't take place in America, true crime, like Pol Pot. We haven't seen anything on Pol Pot ever, the Cambodian genocide. So again, I mean, some of these true, like you said, true crimes, that's all the rage, and I love it.
Yeah.
Just keep bringing them.
Bring that Waco
with
Taylor Kitsch. Get this. I like it.
Yeah. Keep bringing it. All right, Sinead, what's next?
Deadline broke the news last week that J.J. Abrams is set to produce and likely direct a few episodes of The Knicks, a TV adaptation of Nathan Hill's novel of the same name. He'll be teaming up with 6,000-time Oscar winner Meryl Streep, who will star in the series as well as produce. There's no distributor secured thus far, but you'd imagine this would be a no-brainer for most outlets. The Knicks, according to Norwegian folklore, is a spirit who sometimes appears as a white horse that steals children away. In Nathan Hill's novel, why is that funny?
Keep going.
Nathan Hill's novel, A Knicks, Josh's new favorite thing, is anything you love that one day disappears, taking with it a piece of your heart. In 2011, Samuel Anderson's mother reappears after being gone for 30 years, having committed an absurd crime. In order to save her, Samuel will have to embark on his own journey, uncovering long-buried secrets about the woman he thought he knew. David, if this were set in England, would you be more excited to see it?
Everything that is set in England is always better. I'm always more excited to see it. But
as an American, I take offense to
that. Was it the dentist just said British problems, biggest British problems?
Yeah,
very,
it's on Netflix.
Very British problems.
Very British problems is apparently going to be your new favorite show.
I'm
going
to start watching that right after I start. There's so many good British programs to talk about right now, but this is not the time or place to do, well, it is, but not this subject. So
David just watches British Parliament just for fun.
He's just like, ooh, the Pouch of Wig is so beautiful.
And there's all these shows on. We got Poldark's back on in the UK. We got Victoria. There's a show about Queen Victoria. I mean, there's so much good stuff right now.
Oh, my God.
There's so much good stuff.
You guys, Queen Victoria.
But
did you see what happened on Queen Victoria?
I mean, Queen Victoria, that show's hot right now. So ooh. I'm going to step back and let's talk about the Knicks. So okay. I'm all about teams. We're talking about teams with Octavia Spencer and the Jonestown, Vince Gilligan, Michelle Maclaren, big, big powerhouse teams. Now, seeing J.J. Abrams' name doesn't really do much for me because J.J.'s... No. Hold on a minute. Let me explain. I love JJ, but JJ's at a level right now where he's like Spielberg. And Spielberg just attached their names to stuff. It's like, oh, presented by Steven Spielberg. It's like, well, who cares? Like, Spielberg's not directing it. He's not writing it. He may have a few notes he throws at it, but JJ's such a big level.
Shia Griffin over here.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is I trust and I love... 1,000-time Academy Award winner Meryl Streep. I don't know why I blanked out her name because Devil Wears Prada is one of my favorite movies. So I love that movie.
Oh,
right?
God, I love you so much.
That movie's good too. No,
he's such a masculine man that he can admit that.
So I trust Meryl Streep. She's a fantastic actress. I'm excited to see her in this project. And the fact that a white horse comes and steals your kids, that's terrifying.
Yeah,
that's terrifying.
Why I laughed when Sinead was reading that was because it's like every Scandinavian child like folktale is like, and this creature comes and steals your children.
That's horrible.
Like that, yeah, it's horrible. I feel like they all teach that same lesson. Am I wrong?
That has never happened to me once at IKEA, but I do find this interesting. So I have to say, the reason that I'm kind of ignoring you guys is because, I'm sorry, I was on my phone, because I'm looking at this and I'm like, the cover of that book doesn't make any sense for the show.
It looks
that
like
you guys
Woodstock.
Are talking about. Yeah. It looks like some sort of like political rally in the 1960s. Right. When you said the Knicks, I thought of Nixon. So I'm trying to find anything that talks about what the hell this is actually about. People are like, it made me laugh. It made me cry. It's melancholy. It's resonant. It's a tale about political American psyche. I don't know. I think that what you guys are talking about in terms of this show, I think anytime you have J.J. Abrams, whether he's a producer, a director, whatever, people are going to jump on it.
Yeah.
You throw Meryl Streep into it, Girl, please. Blowing up. People will pay so much money for it. And I would watch anything she did. I sat through that garbage movie that Diablo Cody wrote it. Yeah, Ricky and the Flash. Ooh, because I like her that much. I watched Mamma Mia because I like her that much. The only thing that I'm concerned about is I feel like we're this... What I'm wondering is this like a book basically about like a woman who was... But the
it takes place in 1968.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's hot. That's hot.
It's probably based on
that's
the hot. Setting. Yeah. But it, so when said the Knicks also refers to anything that you love
that disappears.
That right. goes away. So right. Maybe it's just the setting of it all and how the time at that... That time.
Right, for like Vietnam and all this stuff. Yeah. So, I mean, that's a very turbulent time in our society.
What I was
society.
Hoping was, is we were talking about like real crime.
Yeah.
And the people who ran my daycare center were actually living underground at the time. They were the leaders of the Weather Underground. Hmm. The woman was the most wanted woman on the FBI top 10 most wanted list for like 20 years.
I'm sorry. Who ran your daycare? Who that, took care that, of you as a child?
Does this explain everything?
An amazing woman. Her name is Bernadine.
What did you learn today at daycare? That the commies are right.
I am not saying that that is inaccurate.
Wait, so someone in the FBI's most wanted took care of you as a child.
No,
every
not
day.
Just me. Me and several of their children. Oh, actually, her husband God. Was. She was a woman, and she was on the top 10 most wanted list. But it was because
who,
they were
who
involved.
Was the guy that ran it?
He was actually good friends with Barack. Bulger? No, he was Barack Obama's friend, and it became a big thing when Barack Obama was trying to get. Oh. Sinead looks like she's going to die. Let me explain.
I'm
this.
Shocked
Hold
too.
On. These people were. It was the weather.
How do you run a daycare center and be on the FBI's top?
Because
you can't do. Both. You can't do
they
both.
I don't know.
Where'd your parents
you
drop you off? Like in a sewer?
Hold on. All right, everybody, everybody calm down. When you say underground, you literally mean the daycare center was underground.
No, I mean
in
that
the
they
sewer?
Were
underground
they
in were secrecy.
Living, they were living Thanks, different Sinead. Lives. They had her name was Tony, I think, at the time. Her name was Tony, and they were like, it was,
like,
a, it was a fake. But basically what it was the Weather Underground were people that were radical anti-Vietnam activists. They blew up draft boards. They actually planted a bomb at the Pentagon. But the one thing they always made sure was that nobody
and
was
in
ever.
In my mashed potatoes at lunch.
No, they so. Always made sure that nobody was injured during their bombings. They always cleared out the building. So it wasn't
that's
like.
Nice of them.
Well, thank God for that. Nice you know what? What kind-hearted people
this
they are.
This has gone off the rails. They were also partnered with the Black Panthers. At this point, I feel like this tragic story has gone completely off the rails. But what I was hoping was maybe this had something to do with that, and maybe she was involved in something like that, because that's what I—that was the vibe I got from the cover of the book, which was why I was Googling. I feel like this is gone. This was a very long driveway.
I wanted to tell
a
really funny
house.
Story about me and Meryl Streep, but we'll save that
please
for another
do.
Time.
You know Meryl Streep?
And that was gone to the next story.
So
this
when,
is a mess.
When Conan O'Brien did his that short stint as the Tonight Show host, which was only about a month and a half, I went to go see one of the episodes because it was shot over here at Universal, and Meryl Streep was a guest. On the show. And so she's coming out, and you know what people don't realize is when you're shooting those shows and they go to commercial break, the whole set goes quiet and he's talking, and then like do they do promos and stuff. And so they're walking Meryl Streep out. I was only three rows out, and she's walking by, and she looked at me. We like locked eyes, and I go, "I love you, Meryl." I was like 29 years old. She goes, "I love you too, sweetheart." And she kept walking. Aww. And I was like, "Hey, thanks, Meryl." Awesome. That's my only story. The underground didn't run my daycare. It was a bunch of nuns in a Catholic school.
Yeah,
so.
I feel like anything that you say now just
it's
doesn't
terrible.
Even matter.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
All right, Sinead, let's go to the next story. What's our next underground TV topic?
According to a report from Variety, NBC picked up a script for First Responders from Vin Diesel's One Race TV production company. The high-action procedural follows young veterans struggling to reintegrate into society while heroically saving civilian lives along the way. The team in question, an elite search and rescue operation run by husband and wife duo Doc and Lil Pierce from their Southern California coastal base, offers a sense of family and community for its young veteran members. Despite Doc and Lil's heroic successes, they're still caught up in solving the mystery of their son's disappearance and will stop at nothing to bring him back home. Sasha, will they solve it?
Oh, they will solve it, because this is basically just Dominic Toretto with a wife and maybe like doing some sort of weird search and rescue, like that terrible Ashton Kutcher movie where he was a rescue swimmer.
Guardian.
There you go. Good boy.
Him and Kevin Costner.
There you go. Kevin Costner. And
Academy nominated Guardian. No.
What? But I mean, this is what I think is interesting. So there's been so much talk about whether or not The Rock and Vin Diesel were actually fighting, or if that whole thing was just a
publicity stunt.
But The Rock is constantly doing TV stuff, is always developing stuff, is signed on for like a million things. So now I feel like The Rock's like, I gotta do that too.
And Vin Diesel's gotta do that too.
Sorry. Yeah. Vin Diesel is racing to try to do that also.
Do you think he's racing a little too fast? Maybe a little too furious?
Is he a little too furiously? But does he drift?
Sorry, guys.
Is he drifting? Is he Tokyo drifting? Because this show is. Yeah. This is off the rails. But the thing is if I have to watch a show basically that is like The Fast and the Furious, but like with a husband and wife team, I'm into it. I think I'd be more into it though if The Rock did it.
There's just something about this that sounds very like done already. Mm-hmm. You know, not the procedural part, not that they solved it part. I know we make that joke all the time, but like, you know, people coming back, and not to like make light of anything, veterans or when they come back from war, but I feel like we're seeing a ton of this, and it's like, okay, so you have this second storyline of them always trying to find their son, but in the meantime they have like a crime of the week. It does. It just like it almost feels like The Killing mixed with the CSI mixed with like an NCIS. It just like doesn't really like do it for me. I mean, I don't know.
It's network TV. You have to hit those beats, you know. Yeah. I mean, sometimes shows can hit those beats and still be incredible. I mean, Hannibal had crime of the week. I mean, there was a massive crazy murder, and they'd have to go in and not solve it, but kind of figure out what was going on, and then move up to the next storyline. You have to hit those beats, but you can still have a special show, a still good series within those beats. Yeah. But this does just seem very formulaic. Seems like something that we have seen before.
Well, and the other thing is The Rock tends to develop things that he's going to be in. Vin Diesel as a producer. I mean, we're talking before about Octavia Spencer. Octavia Spencer, what does she bring with a producerial eye? What is Vin Diesel? I keep calling him the Vin Diesel.
What does Vin Diesel bring as a producer because I will freely
admit that I love the Fast and Furious movies, partially because they are ridiculous. If the Fast and Furious movies were like on a quest to find their son lost in the woods somewhere, I don't know that I would be able to invest in them the same way that I do. So unless he stars in it, I don't know that this can work.
Yeah, if he was attached, if we knew for sure he was starring, I would definitely check it out.
I just keep wondering, can you actually jump a Lamborghini from a building to a building in
you
Dubai?
You can if you're in the Fast and Furious universe, because that's where all the flying squirrel like dynamics work.
Yeah.
That's also where you can jump off of a tank and land across a freeway and catch someone midair, and neither of you die.
Yeah,
I love the Fast and Furious.
Before we transition, can I address, some people last week kept saying David's was lit. Last week, I guess they thought I was. No, I wasn't. I was just, I guess maybe I was in a goofy mood. I was a little bit sick, so maybe I had some drugs in me, but people kept saying I was like lit. Like, David was lit in this episode.
As an aside, David is not an alcoholic.
Yeah, well, we do not promote excessive drinking and drugs on this show, even though.
We don't.
Sasha and Josh have some very good.
What? I am completely sober. No,
don't put Sasha in my wheelhouse here.
Damn, they're straight edge. Yeah,
okay, I don't have a drinking problem. Drinking has a problem with me. All right, let's go to the superhero rundown. A lot to talk about this week. Obviously, next week, you know, we've got the after TV talk of next week. We have, you know, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And then a couple weeks we have Arrow and The Flash. And all these shows starting out, fall is coming in hot. A lot of people, you guys have been asking for like a fall preview. We pretty much did that right after the upfront. So we're not going to really do a big fall TV preview show. We will talk about a lot about the new pilots, depending on the ones that we actually get around to watching and the ones we're a little more excited to. So if you guys so happen to watch one and you think we should, just recommend it. That being said, Sinead, what's up here first on the Superhero Rundown?
Sinead.
Thank goodness, because usually I get Sasha, what do you think?
All right, last week we talked about the Black Lightning series in development from Arrow and The Flash producer Greg Berlanti and the networks or streaming sites we'd like to see it land. But we never mentioned Fox, which last week ordered a pilot production commitment to the series. David, Fox has Gotham. Does it seem like the right fit for Black Lightning?
I do. It's funny. I was talking to Mrs. Griffin, who's my mother, before on the way to the studio, and she was asking me, like, what's Black Lightning? I said, that's a good question.
Is that how she speaks?
No, she doesn't talk like that. She's very refined.
David's mom is lit.
I feel like
Kathy, hopefully not lit.
We don't think that you talk like that. That's like
David Griffin just made his mom like.
It's like how my mom always goes, Sasha, what is it? Like, my mom doesn't actually sound like that.
No, it don't sound like that. But so
my mom just on the phone going,
Josh.
So how did you explain Black Lightning to Kathy?
I didn't really have a good explanation, but what I did is a black guy with electrical power. That's about all I need to know. No, but some people were asking me, David, how can I find out more about Black Lightning? There's a very good book called Black Lightning Year One, written in 2010. Check that out. Read that. Read up on Black Lightning. I think Fox is a great fit for it.
This is scaring me.
Why?
Because I feel like we saw a horrible version of this with Jamie Foxx in that garbage Spider-Man movie.
Yeah, Spider-Man 2. But, okay, so here's my thing.
Oh, yeah.
Fox, at least, what I like about Fox. I think Fox, like ABC, always be canceling. But I think Fox gives shows a chance that wouldn't make it on other of the major networks, NBC, CBS.
It's not a bad call.
Because so Firefly, Dollhouse, Almost Human. I feel like those shows wouldn't end up like on an ABC necessarily, but Fox at least gives these shows a chance. And with Greg Berlanti backing it, worst comes to worst, we'll just throw it back on the CW. CW. Yeah. So I think this is actually a good place. Let's see if it goes mainstream, and if not, let's put it on the CW.
Interesting.
I love it.
All right.
I think I'm on board. I haven't watched Gotham, but I keep watching.
I was just going to ask you, how is Gotham doing?
See, like, I haven't watched either the first two seasons. They did solve it. But like the teasers for this season kind of looks kind of cool. I
Gotham
might check it
has
out.
Great advertising, and I'm so happy that they explore all these cool villains. I want to watch the Joker, that kid from Shameless.
Yeah.
That actor's really good. And also, Bruno Heller writes Gotham. He created Rome on HBO. Yeah. He's an amazing writer, but it's just kind of like he also wrote on The Mentalist, and it's just like
I
saw
when it came out. I thought it was going to have way more fanfare, and like it was going to be way more talked about, and it wasn't.
Mm-hmm. So. People who love Gotham, though, they have a passionate fan base. Very passionate.
All right, Sinéad, what's next?
In a new clip from Marvel's Luke Cage, which premieres on Netflix starting September 30th, the brawler from Harlem interrupts a shakedown at a Chinese restaurant and then beats up everyone. He apparently loves orange chicken. Me too. Sasha, do you think you and Luke Cage could be friends?
Hell yeah. And at the end of this, my primary thought was, I want cold sesame noodles, which you can only get in New York. Yeah. They're so good. They are giving us the most delectable bites of
no
Luke
plot,
Cage.
No nothing, and I don't care.
Just rad action. Yeah. Rad. Like, when you watch the slow-mo punch and, like, the way...
his bone comes out.
Oh, I thought it was awesome. Yeah, yeah. Oh, it was so cool. And especially because I was watching the fights this weekend and somebody, Travis Brown, broke his finger. So I was like, oh, it's like the Travis Brown fight.
CM Punk broke his career.
Oh.
Poor CM Punk.
He tried.
Too soon? What, are we too soon making fun? Never mind.
Wow. Jesus. No, I thought the Luke Cage thing, it looks...
Yeah, I... You know what I love about the scene? Because we've seen that punch, but we haven't seen that whole scene, right? And what I love about it is that just like, he's just like, wah! And these people fly out of the building.
I thought the bullet shot was very cool.
I will say, if I was the Chinese owners, they're like, thanks for saving us, but could you get somebody to replace all of the windows?
That's
that
a lot of money.
Insurance
will cover that. Insurance is going to cover that.
So I thought that too.
Well, I love how the guy has his little, his guy there. He's like, hey man. He's like, what's up? He just kind of stands up and thinks he's going to do something. Just, he just gets wrecked. It's
I mean,
shame.
We're not there yet. We will get there with spoilers, but it's dangerous to eat in New York.
Yeah.
It's dangerous to eat in New York on TV right now.
This may be the first time that I like, I might Narcos style binge this, where as soon as it comes out at midnight, I'll just drink Red Bull all night and binge it until the morning and try to be like that first person.
You do
finishes.
Realize it will still be there in the morning when
I know.
You wake up, right?
That always makes me so mad. I mean, he's like, oh yeah, I watched all of Narcos season 2.
He's all twitching. Yeah.
I'm like, calm down, dude. It's not going anywhere.
Right?
No, the thing is, like, if we...
That was literally word for word our conversation about Narcos. It's like, I watched it all weekend.
I really wish fans could see our text message chain. We all text each other all throughout the whole week. And Josh will come in being like, hey, did you guys watch? We're going to talk about One Mississippi a little bit. And then somebody be like, no, I didn't like it. And then be like, oh, I watched the whole thing. What are you, crazy?
This
I love
morning this
thing.
At like 1:30, like, this morning thing? At 1:30, he's like, where is Son of Zorn?
I do. I think TV has become like a
I'd already been asleep for 2 hours when I sent that text.
That was amazing. Yeah. I know. There was a moment yesterday where I almost screen grabbed it and put it on Twitter because I'm like, this is out of control.
Okay, so I have like a minor form of insomnia, and then I have like a minor form of narcolepsy where I can fall asleep anywhere, but I also can't fall asleep a lot of times. It's so weird. I swear to God.
A TV show. That's a sitcom.
So
that's
last night, I'm laying in bed, and my lady rolls over, and she's like, what are you doing? And I was like, just watching Ray Donovan. Like, I was.
Did you have your headphones on?
I was sitting there with my phone.
You're such a nerd.
I know. It's
narcolepsy and insomnia. Yeah.
That's impossible.
Throw it all together. Put a little magic bullet.
You get Macuga.
Drink it. Macuga. Yeah. So, all right, Sinéad. Last thing in the superhero rundown.
Jeez. In a newly released synopsis from Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., it appears that we will see Ghost Rider right away. The synopsis for episode 2 of season 4 is titled Meet the New Boss, and it reads, Daisy sets out to battle Ghost Rider, but at a terrible cost. The new director's bold agenda shocks everyone. We also got our first images of the flaming Dodge Charger and Robbie Reyes with a skull, as well as a 15-second TV spot, and it's all leading up to that premiere on September 20th. Josh, did the new images make Nick Cage set his DVR?
Come on. This is awesome. The pictures are sick. The car looks awesome. The effects look great. All the, like, even those quick things, it was only a 15-second spot. I got to tell you, if you're not watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I hope this kind of brings you to the show, because they've really done a bang-up job, and I'm really excited to see that they, like, are spending a little bit of time and money on this Ghost Rider character, and they're giving us these little snippets and not a ton of it to really amp up the anticipation. So I'm just like, what do you think, Sinead?
I'm so excited. Yeah. You know how I feel about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. It was, like, it shocked me this entire year, because I'd never expected to fall in love with a show like this. Yeah. It's just one of those shows that I can put on anytime, any place. It's so easy to watch. It's highly entertaining. It's not the greatest television you will ever watch. Like, don't get me wrong. It's not, like, expertly written, but it is so entertaining. It's mm-hmm. just a great show to go to after all your, like, hard-hitting TV. It's, like, a nice thing to wind down with, and I'm so ready for this season.
I'm hoping at, like, the premiere, or there's going to be some app or something to promote the thing, like, or, like, a Snapchat filter.
Oh, yeah.
Where your face turns into the skull.
Totally.
Right?
Gotta the have flaming that. Skull?
The flaming skull, yeah.
You know what, Sinead? You should go over to Josh's house at, like, 1:30 in the morning and crawl into bed and just watch with your headphones and wake Amanda up and freak her out.
I'm just like, hey,
hello.
Girl.
What's up, girl?
What's up, Josh?
Babe, you got way smaller and got boobs. I'm like, yep, welcome to the Thunderdome. All right. Guys, we are going to go. That was it for Superhero Rundown. If you guys have any kind of superhero show news and stuff, you guys have been awesome about, like, sending us tweets or Instagram messages or Facebook things, tagging us in news stories. So we really, really appreciate it, because sometimes it is a little hard and we don't get to see and get everything. So thank you always for sending that. We are going to go into our Mr. Robot review. Now, listen, Cody, you want to throw up the spoiler alert? There we go. Zing, zang, zong. Nice point there, Sasha.
Thanks, dude.
So, like, give yourself a couple seconds if you don't want to know the Mr. Robot thing. We'll talk about it for the next few or 4 or 5 minutes. Last couple of weeks, we've gotten a lot of hate on our comments here on
the
show.
We just don't get it, Josh.
We don't get it.
You just don't get it. You don't understand what the show is trying to do.
I've been stoked the last couple of weeks. Okay. Continue.
Well, I haven't thought that the last couple were amazing, and they're like, you don't really get it. It's just a differing of opinions.
That's
all
it is.
You don't have to insult my personal welfare. But I will say that this episode was a real comeback. Mm. It really, this episode was bad ace. Somebody sent me a subtitled of what that last scene
that
was. Did you watch that?
Mm-hmm. Well, the audio cranked up really high. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I will say, I think without the lollipop in her mouth, this was Dom's redemption episode for me. In the hospital, as she's thinking about it, she's looking at the TV. Brilliantly written scene, a really good acted scene.
Mm-hmm. See, here's the thing. I'll get the hate this time, because I was like, you missed. They missed. The Dark Army missed. Yeah. I wanted her dead so bad. I was so stoked. I'm like, there's no way. There's no way. And she was standing up. You're standing up. She was a much easier target.
Big time
spoiler alert. I think Cisco's totally dead. I think Darlene.
Oh, he's dead.
Cisco's dead. Darlene is alive. She's going to have to deal with it. Because there was a moment in the episode where she was talking about how it's always Elliot and I'm always behind. And I was like, wait, is Darlene a figment of Elliot's imagination too?
Right.
But I don't think that's what's going on. It's just that you have to question that always with Mr. Robot.
Cool.
But I was pissed. I'm like, dude, Dom totally should be. She should have been gagged.
Well, the thing is, like, he's in the middle of a. I don't know why.
We didn't, like, nothing has been said that Dark Army is, like, are snipers. They're just hackers with machine guns.
But if you're standing at a window and the army takes
in
out.
In all black with a machine gun in your right, just, like, staring, you know?
But she was standing up. Like, she would have gotten
bullets
shot.
Bullets are this big.
She would have gotten shot. She would because
maybe she did get shot.
No,
maybe she got an arm
whatever.
Or like in a leg.
I was bummed she wasn't dead. I was bummed, but
Sasha,
it was
really
a great episode.
It was an expertly crafted scene too, especially with the countdown.
Yeah,
you saw like the walking. You know, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, and then the shooting started. I mean, it was just all well crafted. I like how we were at a distance. Yeah, they wouldn't kill Darlene from that far away. You don't kill a major character that far away when you can't hardly even see the person. Mm-hmm. So she's gonna be okay. She might be trying to got shot.
Yeah,
but she's gonna be okay.
Well, and Cisco,
also really cool this here. This scene was fantastic.
Yeah.
I love Tyrell's wife.
Yes.
And I also love when Elliot and her are together, because they're so different. It was just really cool. She's like, do you really want to say no to me?
Well, this whole
that was
thing,
a nice scene.
Really, there have been so many fan theories that Elliot is Tyrell. And when you're talking, like when Jonna is talking about, like, my husband always gives me gifts and always does these things and I wear these because they're my favorite. I'm like, is she speaking in code because he is him?
trying to get him to remember.
Yeah.
You think Elliot is Tyrell?
There was that crazy shot that was like the POV throughout the whole room in the apartment.
Yeah.
What do you guys think that shot meant?
I don't. I mean, does he have like some sort of surveillance on him?
That was my thought.
Or is that like his point of view?
I don't know. But I thought that shot was so specific.
Yeah.
And who do we think grabbed Angela out of the subway?
I mean, you see this stuff for next week. She's like, where are you taking her? Something. I don't know. She's okay, but you wonder, somebody's taking her somewhere. I think it's the people she met with when she almost confessed and gave the information. She backed away and left. Yeah. I think it might be those people. Mm-hmm. I think it's that organization.
But why do you think she's thrown in the back of a van then? Because I think it might be Dark Army. Because if she's thrown in the back of a van, wouldn't she be like sort of sitting in a cell and wouldn't they be answering her questions? It could be that creepy ass woman who was like, come down this very dark hallway.
Talk to us. I think it's her.
My friends are waiting for you. I mean, the thing that I think was so brilliant about that is when she went to that nuclear facility, she gave herself a great alibi with Dom because now it can seem like everything she's doing is because she's trying to bring down E-Corp because she wants justice for her mom. But I don't know. It was a really good episode. But I think this whole season's been awesome.
I think when Josh and I would both agree, I think when we say that we didn't like an episode a little bit more than the others,
I
think the comment section thinks that like these guys think it's a bad show. No, I don't think it's a bad show. It's just maybe an episode I didn't like as much as another one, but I still think this is one of the best shows on television right now. It's still a well-written, well-directed show.
Yeah, I just don't know how we can get a satisfying ending to this season.
To this season? My biggest thing is just don't drag it out. If this is Act 2, which Esmeralda said, this is part of Act 2. Okay, maybe 4 seasons max, no more than 4, maybe 3, maybe next season should be the last one.
Esmeralda's always said either 4 to 5.
Good. Okay.
I would love to see 3.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Because you need answers?
I want answers.
Well, that's the thing, is we're coming to the end of the show for this season, and I feel like there's so many loose ends.
Like, I feel like in
two more episodes left, just two more. Yeah.
I feel like in season 1, we got like a big arc. Season 2 so far, there's been some reveals, but we haven't gone anywhere.
See, and I feel like in season 2, I've had more like moments than we had in season 1. And I think we've had major character reveals. We just haven't had as many big plot reveals. I think it's been laying more landmines.
I know. I agree.
But dude, Darlene, like when she...
Yeah.
Come on. That was big.
That was big. I mean, that's when the whole crew turned. They were out for moral justice. Yeah. And now they're actually murderers, which was a huge,
change. It broke the group up.
Yeah.
Because the other two were like, that's not us. We're not murderers. Right. The other guy's kind of her boyfriend, who's probably dead now, is just kind of sticking around. But I don't think he's a murderer either. But he's with her. So
not anymore. R.I.P. R.I.P.
He's
Cisco.
Gone. He's dead. He's dead.
My guess is he's dead. Okay. Before we go, let's give it some ratings. David, out of how many do you give it?
I give it a 4.5 out of 5.
Okay.
Sasha? If they'd actually hit Dom, I would have given it a 4.9. But as it is, I give it a 4.75.
I'm going to give it a hard 4 out of 5.
Ooh.
But I'm kind of setting a little bit of a foundation here, because I think the season finale is going
to
be...
You need room to grow. You want that penultimate. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, fine. Then I give it a 4.6.
Yes. There we go.
Okay, room to grow. And one.
Now we're going to go to talk about something that doesn't...
Cody, you can get rid of the spoiler alert. We are going to move on to our pilot review of the much anticipated show, Atlanta on FX. This show... They gave us 2 episodes. Yeah, let's just, I mean, really. David said he's seen the first episodes 3 times. I've watched them through twice. Probably going to watch them a 3rd time. This was so well done. It was real life. It was real comedy. There was nothing like in your face about it. It was just that nonchalance of like Southern mentality a little bit with music and like the dirty grittiness of Atlanta and also, you know, life in general of like, I mean, Donald Glover's character went to Yale. You know, he's a really smart dude. Or Princeton. I'm sorry, Princeton.
What happened to Princeton?
What happened to Princeton? Yeah. And the guy who plays Paperboy.
Brian Tyree Henry
he's in Vice Principals. Dude is awesome. I can't wait to see where this show goes. We're getting 10 episodes. You know, I thought there was going to be a little more about music, which I'm guessing we'll get to see. Like, there'll be a little more, because we've had so many music shows that we've all... David had his vinyl. I had my Get Down. I know none of you guys really like the Get Down. And I thought this one was going to be more centered around music. But I don't know if it will or if it won't. And I really don't know if I care.
Well, we've talked a lot about whether or not it's possible to do a good music show.
Yeah.
This show, I said, I tweeted out, if this show had kittens, it would be my favorite thing of all time. I have never, ever reached out to FX and been like, I'm pulling the I work for you card. The minute these aired, I pulled the I work for you card. And I was like, you got to send me more episodes.
Yeah.
And I got them.
Oh,
this
no.
is nice. So brilliant on every single level. Donald Glover, I want to... You. Sorry, Mrs. Griffin. I want to have all
your husband. Your,
my husband is cool with it because I want to have all the creativity babies with this man. Donald Glover's brain, I want to lick it. I want to suck it. I want to make sweet, sweet love to it. This show, the way it's shot, the way it is
Cody,
written.
Can you edit in some love bubbles around her head or anything? Some creepy love
This show is, it's perfect. It, creepy? Oh, it's creepy that I have good taste. This show is perfect. <Good
job. laughs> Was I just verbally attacked? I'm totally making a joke. Anyway, go ahead.
I love you, yeah, Josh. I just don't love you as much as I love Atlanta. Okay, and homeboy who was Snoop in Straight Outta Compton is genius. The show
Keith
is
Stanfield,
genius.
Yeah.
Rat phones.
All I know is rat phones. I want that lemon pepper chicken with the sauce. I want it.
That
I want
looks,
it.
When they smell the box.
The minute that this show, when he's laying in bed with her and goes, I had this crazy dream, there was a girl in it. What'd she look like? Fat, and uninteresting.
Ugly.
I was like, that's the answer. Yeah. And then when he starts smelling her breath and goes, is that curry? Yeah. And starts kissing her. I love it. Yeah. It's the best.
It really
it's
is.
The best. It and is a perfect show.
You know what it is too, is I've only been to Atlanta twice and I've don't think I've spent time in the neighborhood where they are in Decatur or whatever, but they're like the one beautiful thing that this did that Steven Soderbergh did well in The Girlfriend Experience is that room tone. That like those cicadas always like you hear it, you feel what it's like to be like walking around Atlanta. It's a little hot, it's kind of spread out, it's a little dirty. Like the dad and mom were hysterical.
Oh, and
when the girl's like, oh, she's got a date, and the mom's like, good for her.
Isaiah, you know, like, Whitlock Jr., will we get the signature?
It's just, what do you think, David?
Yeah. Stop it!
No.
No. He loves it.
I love this show. Like I said, I've seen it three times all the way through.
I got really scared.
I know I talk about like my white escapism. This show, I love how, and I don't, this is not a racial thing. I love how black it is. Unapologetically black.
Yeah.
It is, in talking about African-American culture in Atlanta, especially the trap rap community in Atlanta, and it's just, it's embracing its heritage and its roots just so fully and beautifully. And it's, I mean, he wants it to be, he's even, Donald Glover said he wants it to be Twin Peaks meets hip hop.
Yeah.
That's why this weird stuff, that's why there's deja vu, there's dogs, and there's some guy who looks like he works for Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam and says, boy, if you don't eat this sandwich, and then just disappears. I mean, it has that magic to it. It's so, it's magic realism. You know, it's the Latin, you know, Mexican magic realism that their culture has brought to the African-American community, and all these guys are so good. The world is lit. It's a half hour. You're gonna call it a comedy? It's not, it's a drama.
Yeah,
it's a half hour, but it's a drama. I get the
I
whole half hour thing, but it's like,
disagree with you,
it's,
because
it's the definition of a drama.
The best dramas on television are secretly comedies. The Sopranos is one of the funniest shows of all time. It's hilarious.
There were so many things, like when he lifts up his daughter and he's like, what do you mean? This is a perfect place for you, because they're fighting.
Yeah.
That was genius. The scene in the jail when the ex-boyfriend and girlfriend, or like maybe current boyfriend and girlfriend, are like talking back and forth, and he's like, I can move.
Yeah.
Everything about this show, I literally feel like Donald Glover reached into my brain, pulled my brain out, put my brain into his brain, put his experience through my mouth, and like, this is like everything I aspire to create.
It's really good. Sinéad, what do you think?
I
love
it. Yeah, I really, really liked it too. I mean, Sasha's got it down perfectly. It's so well written, and so like, you just want to keep watching it over and over and over again. I will say, I also thought that it was going to be have a lot more to do with music, but I also am fine if it doesn't go any heavier into it. Like, honestly, like, the show was great. Like, it's so good.
We need you to be on it next season.
100%. Yeah.
I know you guys are really sick.
We need you to get.
And I want to praise your company, FX, for making a show like this.
How about
this?
You take Sinéad to work day?
You don't get to see, and I hate to keep bringing up race, but it's such a big deal with this show because you don't get to see shows. If this was on the CW, they would be hiding behind the fact. They wouldn't, I don't want to say black, but they wouldn't be able to be who they are on this show, which frustrates me. NBC, ABC, they play it safe. This is not a safe show. This is not going to appeal to everybody. I mean, they say the N-word a lot. They're dropping F-bombs over and over and over again.
That great moment.
This is not
going to
be for everybody.
The dude at the radio station dropping the N-word and like the way he deals with it
because
when it comes back later.
Because he's not threatened by Donald Glover, which is an insult, because I've heard that before. He's not threatened by him, so he thinks he can say that and get away with it. But then when he sees a 6'2", 250-pound guy, paperboy, he's like, oh, this is a stupid white boy story. I mean, I don't even know why I said it. I mean, there's so many good moments that I resonate with because of the way I was brought up that it's just this. I love this show. This is a perfect show. Perfect. I agree. It's a perfect show.
We've been waiting to talk about a show like this for a while.
Yeah. This show makes me so happy. Yeah.
If you aren't watching Atlanta on FX, just
you're depriving yourself of a great experience. This, I will say, we talk a lot about how like we love the 8-12 episode model. This is an instance where I almost wish I hadn't discovered the show until later.
Right. Mm.
Because I want 22 episodes. I want this to go 100 episodes.
Or it needs to be dumped all at once. Yeah. This is perfect for binging. This is a binging show. Yeah.
Because it's just, and the characters, like,
I like feel 10. Like, I'll be honest with you. I know where you're going with 22, but I like 10.
I feel like they're my friends. Like, I got to the end of a book the other day and I was sobbing. And my husband was like, why are you crying? And I was like, because they were my friends and now it's over. Yeah. And I feel that way with this show. I feel like when the show is over, I'm going to cry because I feel like these are friends that I'm invested in, and I'm not going to be able to like text them and be like, sup, bruh.
Yeah. Sup, bruh. all right. That was our pilot review of Atlanta. Again, it's on FX. Guys, check it out.
What are we going to get it? Out of lemon pepper
one
chickens?
One of our fans, I forget who.
Lemon pepper chickens.
Who tweeted at me, but he's like, you should rank it out of rat phones.
So,
I mean, 5 out of 5 rat phones. Like, really?
Yeah.
If lemon pepper chickens, give me all of it. Give me the gold chains. Give me the wheeled out. Was that a Cutlass? That he was driving was
like a Lincoln, something like the big with the 22s. He had 22s on that bad boy. Yeah,
5 out of 5 rat phones for sure.
Yeah. 5 out of 5. It just sucks that this week we're only going to get a half hour episode. We're not going to get 2 half hour episodes. Sasha has them.
It's a 5 for sure. Go watch it.
So if you add us all up, that's 2 tans. It's 2 tans.
It's
just
tans.
Like Sinead. We should just rank everything out of tens, like out of Sinead's.
Oh,
so like
perfect.
1 out of 10 Sinead's.
These
are
10 tans.
No, don't do that. Don't do that. Please don't do that.
It's 100. Okay. Keep it at 100.
Yes, they're making me blush.
No.
I'm not supposed to be able to blush.
Oh, you're not?
Stop it.
No.
Okay, guys, so next week, before we get into highs and lows, tell you guys about a couple things going on here, Collider TV Talk. This Sunday, September 18th, we will be doing an Emmy reaction show. It'll go up probably around 9:30 on Sunday night. So we're going to watch the Emmys on the East Coast feed, do the post show, and talk about how we thought about winners and losers. And that Sasha and I will be here. Sinead will be here. David, unfortunately, will not be here. We'll probably get Perry Nemirov to sit in for David.
Where are you going to be?
I got things to do.
What do you
got to
do?
I got places to be.
Yeah, he's cool.
Is Kathy going to be there?
No, Kathy's back out east. I won't see her for a while.
All right, fine.
Hey, Miss Griffin.
Hi, Mrs. Griffin.
And then Sasha and I were lucky enough to interview Eric Lang, who plays a CIA agent on Narcos Season 2. He was absolutely fantastic. You guys know him from Lost. He was great in that show, and we just had a really great interview with him. So we're going to show you guys a clip of that next week on TV Talk and then release the full interview after the show. So look out for that. Again, our interview with Eric Lang. So let's get into highs and lows. Let's burn through these bad boys. We got a lot to go through. Sinead, what is first?
First up, 1 Mississippi.
Okay, I'm going to give it a high.
Show sucked all the donkey balls. This goes
the
way low.
Can you just be a little nicer? I know Tig.
Okay,
can you just like be a little
Tig
nicer?
Tig is delightful. I love her stand-up. The show is garbage. The show is like, this is what happens when you're famous and you have famous friends and your famous friends are like, we should do a show about you. Like, how many people have come up to you, Josh, and been like, you're hilarious. You should have your own show. Only this actually happened. Mm. And the acting is terrible.
You don't
terrible.
Think a show about me would be any good?
I would do a show with you. I love doing shows with you. Okay. You're a great show. But this was a terrible show, and I wanted to like it because I like Nicole Heffa, who did like Kicking and Screaming, the director.
Helen Coffer.
Whatever. I hated it. I hated it. It's self-indulgent. It's narcissistic. It's boring.
Do you know what
the
I
acting
thought was,
is bad.
Was,
hated it.
I think the redeeming person in the whole show was the brother.
The brother who looks like Drew McWeeny?
Yes.
But even that was not.
Man.
No,
David,
that
what do you think? I'm getting it high.
No, this is a low. We go from talking about one of the most beautifully imaginative shows on television in Atlanta to the blandest, Like, just death. Okay. It just, when I watch it, it just seems like, just, it feels like death. Okay. I just want to die. I'd rather just want to die.
But it's not even just like, die. It's not even,
listen, if David doesn't like awful. It, yes, and you don't like it.
I'm usually, like it. I feel like I'm pretty fair on this show. This show, you're, I just kind. Wanted to die.
I love you, David.
It just felt like death.
I'm,
it
was getting horrible. Destroyed.
There's no
over
life
here.
In the show.
Sinead, move on. What's next?
All right, up next is Corey.
Corey on Cinemax. That's a super high.
Super
guys,
high.
Check out Corey, set right after Guys Come Home from Vietnam in Memphis, Tennessee.
Logan Marshall Green.
Yeah, Logan Marshall
Drinking
Green.
Four roses bourbon.
Marlo Stanfield from The Wire is in the first episode. Really, really well done show. Super dark, great nudity, just like any Cinemax show
the
would do.
Butt the wife's butt is a butt's
10. So,
and we get some Logan Marshall Green teen.
Yeah, real. You got to screenshot that. But Sasha sent us a text.
I can write it around.
Sinead, what's next?
Up next is Queen Sugar.
I'm like right here on Queen Sugar. Didn't love it, didn't hate it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a little soapy for me. I mean, it's not bad. It's just,
what's the Mrs. Griffin rating?
Mrs. Griffin is a thumbs up. I talked to my mom. She loves it. She loves Queen Sugar. So,
this is Mrs. Griffin approved.
Oh yeah. So the beginning I thought felt like a Michelle and DJ Ocello video from like 1999.
Wow, Nat then, is calling.
Yeah.
Come on out, man.
I love it.
Come on out, baby, man. She did the head bob real well.
I love the way it was shot.
Yeah, it's pretty.
I think it's beautiful. Is. I love.
I mean,
Tara
Ava DuVernay is great, and all that. Orland stuff is fantastic.
Yeah, from True
from
Blood.
True Blood. Yep. I love her. I love seeing her back on TV.
The guy plays the patriarch figure, the dad. He's a fantastic actor, too.
But I didn't find the story that compelling. Yeah. I didn't think that, like, I knew where it was going. I felt it was really predictable. There was, like, even the moment on the basketball court, which is a great moment, I was
what
like,
what did you do?
I knew that
what
was coming.
What did you do? Like, oh, girl. Oh, that was like, all right.
Saw that coming. Yeah. Saw it coming so far away. But it's gorgeous, and the soundtrack
so are you giving
is great.
It a higher low?
I give it, like, a...
Yeah,
it's
like right
one
in between.
Tick. Okay.
It's not
it's
a bad
Mrs. Griffin approved TV
above,
talk mid.
It's
mid-low.
One tick above medium.
Okay, Sinead, what's next?
Son of Zorn.
Hi.
A special preview.
I loved it. I was a fan.
I was cracking up.
I loved the trailer. I knew I was going to like this show. I'm really looking forward
to
seeing
where
this is going.
I wonder how long this can last. Mm-hmm. I liked it, but from the shows, I'm like, do I want to watch this like an episode? What's this like an episode like 80?
Yeah.
Is it still good? But I like it. I'm here. Good. I'm here
I
now.
I give it a one tick below Ooh. Medium because I actually found it to be, I felt like the joke ran super thin and all the best parts were in the trailer. And I feel like they need to have an actor doing Jason Sudeikis' stuff because I felt like the animation.
It did.
It was
I noticed
very
that.
Disjointed.
You like, could tell the actors, they were like, okay, make a reaction face.
Yeah. Very, very disjointed. Okay. I just didn't love it. Okay. Yeah, and I was bummed because I thought it was going to be like my new favorite thing. I loved this stuff in the beginning.
Sinead, what's next?
Better Things. Did David write the show?
This was
this is my kind of show. One Mississippi is not my kind of white escapism, but Better Things, that I'm all in it, man. I love Pam. She's cute.
I love Pam.
I love her. I love it.
She was incredible in that first Louis C.K. show that was on HBO.
She was in an episode of Star Trek The Next Generation when she was a kid.
Oh.
She was fantastic.
She was on a lot of stuff when she was
in Californication. She was really, really good in that show. I just sometimes I don't love like the inside Hollywood things.
Yeah.
But that scene with her and Constance Zimmer.
That was so good.
Like,
that was the best part of the whole show.
I love just like, of course you're here.
Yeah,
of course you're here.
I want Constance Zimmer to be in everything. So when she showed up, I was
and
like,
then Julie Bowen walks out. It's just great. But I'm going to give this a high. I'm giving this a high.
Hi.
Hi.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
The Strain.
I'm the only one watching The Strain. I don't understand why they have this book that's supposed to solve everything. And they're just like, guys, what's in the book? I'm like, it's a book. Read it. Figure it out. It's like you have the map to the cave. All you got to do is follow the map.
Is the master still around?
Why do
master's
you keep
still around? Because I don't know.
Because you can't sleep.
I'm going right here.
Oh,
Strain.
Boy.
Yeah, next, Sinead.
Josh's favorite show, Fear the Walking Dead.
Like Josh
Hold on.
Oh, my God.
This is like
Hold this on. Is the Josh Macuga hour right now.
I think I'm back on board with having no Lord. Idea what is happening on Fear the Walking Dead. I'm just, again, I'm right here. I keep watching it. That's why I haven't sung.
I would love just to come in one Monday and get a valuable review of Fear the Walking Dead.
Okay,
every week you're like, that's all right.
Here's the thing. The son is, he always has this look on his face like he's holding in like a fart. He's just like. And he's just like, every shot of him just like.
Okay. So come on. It's how many held in farts? That's got to be your Fear the Walking Dead review. How many Fear the Walking Dead farts do you get this week?
6.5.
That's pretty good.
They let all the bodies into the ocean because a current's going to take all the bodies away. Are you kidding me? That's your plan?
That's 6.5?
Yeah.
Jesus. Well,
Anyway, dude. Okay, what's next, Sinéad? Sorry, we got to go.
All right, the descriptions for new episodes of Black Mirror.
Guys, listen, if you're not watching Black Mirror, go back and watch all the episodes. They have Jessica Chastain, they have Mackenzie Davis in these six episodes. The first three released really soon, the next three a little bit later. They have a flashback one. The Black Mirror is incredible. I love the description. Hi.
Hi.
Go.
What's next, Sinéad?
You gotta watch it.
All right, Westworld is set up for 5 seasons.
Yeah, they said in an article
which
that
is crazy.
That they,
with
they
that
have
cast?
An arc.
Ooh.
5 seasons? I guess.
Sir Anthony Hopkins? You gonna stick around for 5 seasons?
We've still haven't seen it.
I say hi, but I'm very. I can't wait for the show to debut. But I don't know. I'm like, will it survive?
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Sinéad, what's next?
The LeBron James Show on Dr. James Andrews.
Listen, I love LeBron James, and I like doctors, but I don't. Dr. Griffin is an orthopedic surgeon, and I'm sure he's a very interesting guy. But I don't know if I want to watch a show about a guy that just does knee surgeries. Going low.
Does he solve it every week?
Yeah, he solves it.
I don't get it.
I'm obligated to give this a high. This is a show that I will watch. I need to support the orthopedic surgeon.
But I
community.
Did like LeBron very much in Trainwreck.
Yes, he was great. All right, Sinéad, what's next?
Katie Sackhoff is back in Star Wars Rebels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she's coming back, reprising her role as a character who was once allied to Darth Maul, and then she in Clone Wars she changed her mind and started working with Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Darth Maul is going to be heavily featured in Star Wars Rebels Season 3, so this is a big move. This is a big character coming back. She's going to be mixing things up. You know, we're going to see what happens. I don't know. I love Katie Sackhoff. I love Battlestar Galactica, Starbuck. I'm glad I'm glad the girl's getting work.
Zing
and
zang.
She's a friend of the Schmoes Network.
Yeah. She is.
So that's always
coming
good
in a few
too.
Weeks.
Yeah.
All right, Sinéad, what's next?
They asked Raylene Woodley if she'd be into Divergent TV, and she was like, nah.
That girl better take
hot
that paycheck.
People running.
That's hilarious.
Low.
Well, the whole thing is like, I mean, that, why are they even bothering trying to do this for television? Mm-hmm. It's just going to fail.
And what's next, Sinéad?
All right, Basilisk from Francis Lawrence and Curtis Gwynn.
So this is like a horror drama on FX. Curtis Gwynn has written a ton of The Walking Dead mm-hmm. episodes. He's actually a really good guy. I've known him for a long time. And Francis Lawrence. So they're bringing this. I mean, this might be something more that I think Nightmares would want to talk about. I brought it up because these horror dramas are like a new hot topic, like a hot property.
Hot topic.
Hot property.
That's because horrors, they're seeing it in the box office. Yeah. Horror movies were the best movies this summer.
Yeah.
Compared to everything else.
Yeah, and Francis Lawrence, he did a lot of the Hunger Games. He directed some Hunger Games stuff.
Yep.
So, what's next, Sinéad?
Riverdale set photos of Josie and the Pussycats.
All black.
I'm so pumped for Riverdale.
It's awesome. Their hair is so beautiful. I want
all right,
their hair.
Sinéad, what's
MacGyver,
next?
First TV spot.
Oh, look you guys.
What? I'm watching it. I'm in. It's
how
a guy I'm in.
Dare
oh my God.
You, David.
It was,
they did the reshoots.
Down.
We did the reshoots.
Down
James
for the
won.
The
re-
are
James
you,
won.
Are you talking about the one where he comes in and he throws the stupid plate at the guy's face? I just spit. I'm so upset.
Yeah, let's move on. And the guy was like, I'm blowing stuff up and looking good
oh
doing
my
or something
God.
Like
low,
that.
That's, low. David Griffin.
Network TV at its finest.
Sinéad, what's
you
next?
You upset me?
All right, next up, Startup on Crackle.
Who's watching Startup?
This was actually shockingly enjoyable. There's a girl whose name I do not know, and the dude who played Darwin in X-Men First Class, they are the standouts of the show, but it's Adam Brody, and I was like, and Martin Freeman, kind of playing a badass. There's weird stuff where there's like completely gratuitous sex multiple times in the show. Josh is like, hi.
That's
so but in general, the show's actually kind of interesting. It's sort of like if E-Coin on Mr. Robot was its own, like if a girl in Miami created the Bitcoin. Like Bitcoin thing. Whoa. And it's her trying to get this thing off the ground. And she, I do not know her name, she is a star. It's really interesting. I don't know. It's kind of good.
Startup on Crackle. Let's check it out. And finally, Shanasty.
Family Ties being adapted into a stage play.
Okay, now, you know when you were talking about when you finished the book and you said, you know, those were my friends, I'm tired. That I cried at the end of Family Ties when I was a kid. This makes me cry because I don't know why you would do something like this. This just leave my Family Ties alone.
Leave it alone.
Just leave it alone.
You're not going to ever recreate that, so just stop.
Low. All right, let's move on to Twitter questions, guys. As always, hashtag @ClatterTVTalk. Send them in during the week. Send them in. We have some great ones this week, so thank you guys for always for watching the show and for sending us Twitter questions. We love hearing from you. Sinéad, what's first?
All right, Aiden tweets, what are your favorite guilty pleasure sitcoms?
Well, we all know if Dennis was here right now, he would say Switched at Birth.
I don't know that that's a sitcom.
Is that a sitcom?
That's an hour long.
It's an hour long drama.
It's a drama. See? They were switched at birth.
Yeah.
That's dramatic. True. That
do you guys remember, probably my guiltiest pleasure sitcom was the show, I can't even remember the name. It was the guys that did the one with Jason Lee. It was their next show. Mm-hmm. It was about the kid who married the serial killer and they had a baby together.
What?
Raising Hope. That's what it was called. Raising Hope with Martha Plimpton. It was on Fox. I watched every episode, and it's just like
was a serial killer an active part of the kid's life?
Every now and then, she would like escape prison, and then it was a weird show. It took place in a weird part. Totally guilty movie, guilty pleasure of a sitcom. I watched every episode, and I don't know why.
So this, I don't know if this will count because it's animated, but I love Archer, and I can just like watch Archer over and over.
I wouldn't call that guilty pleasure. That's just great comedy.
What is guilty pleasure?
Guilty pleasure is like
something
you're embarrassed by, but still like how I love the movie Bad Boys 2 is my favorite movie. Yeah. Everybody makes fun of me. Or the movie Airborne. It's about rollerblading in Cincinnati in the 90s.
Party.
Like it's guilty movie pleasures, guilty TV pleasure. You know, like a Van Damme action movie. Mm-hmm. Which
like I would say that RuPaul's Drag Race, but RuPaul just won best reality show host at the Emmys because it's the best show on television.
Mm-hmm. So Mama's Family back in the day I used to watch a lot. That was kind of a little guilty pleasure. David.
Who was the one who like was Step by Step? Step by Step.
I loved that show.
Yeah, that was
Christine Lincoln. She played Alice.
Wasn't that Suzanne Summers?
Yeah.
The Thigh Master girl? Yeah, I like that show.
So
that
you
was
have
a good
to go
one.
Old school in order to get some of these. Yeah.
Remember I don't watch a lot of sitcoms.
Oh, yeah, I love Dinosaurs.
Not the Mama. That was a great show. Yeah.
Sinead's just looking over there perplexed. She doesn't know.
I'm like, guilty pleasure. Like, I love all the shows that I watch.
Yeah.
And I'm not
I may or may not. All right, Sinead, what's the next question here?
Charles tweets to you guys, what makes a good season?
I like this question.
I like this question, too. Mm. Well, it's certainly not within one Mississippi.
Yeah.
Oh, burn, burn, burn! Shots fired.
Crush Central over here. Let me flip it. I will tell you what kind of makes a bad season and what makes a good season. Okay. I think there are two camps of people that watch The Wire. There's the people that thought The Docs was a great season and the people that thought The Docs didn't need to be in the series because it was the only one that really didn't follow the central storyline, which was the drug cartel in Baltimore, drug trade in Baltimore. I think for a great season, you have to have something for people to really talk about. And like the first three seasons of Sopranos, amazing. Then the fourth season, they went to like these Janus episodes when you really didn't need it. It's when the writers kind of lose their thought process on what the show's about because they didn't think that far in advance or because they were rushed to production. So what makes a great season? Look at, I'm trying to think of like, if you look at Breaking Bad season two, that whole season, you're wondering what that eyeball in the pool is.
Right.
And then it comes to fruition that what it is what it is. I don't want to spoiler anything. Did that make it a great season? I don't know.
So I would say the thing that makes a great season is you have to have characters that you're really, really invested in, and they have to have a strong emotional journey.
Yeah.
And because there has to be an arc. Like the thing that makes a great season is the arc of a character, the arc of a story, the arc of whatever it is that you're following. So like I think Stranger Things is a perfect season because it starts with like five or six central tenets, questions that need to be answered. We're introduced to five or six characters that we're truly invested in.
Yep.
And then that season, we follow these people as they solve the questions and they are changed over the course of the journey to solve them. And that's what made it a perfect season. That's what I think makes a great season.
That's a great call. David?
I guess I want to take it a little smaller level and more talk about like the episodes in general. Is that to make any good show, any first season, second season, third season, you have to care about the characters. That's the biggest thing. I think a lot of shows now are more concerned about the events and thinking that that's going to sell a show. I think TV writing is getting smarter and smarter. Remember after Lost was done, that show The Event came out. And I remember that after the first episode of The Event, it was like, do you want to know what happened to the plane? Tune in next week for the second episode of The Event. And I'm like, but what about the characters?
Yeah.
It's all about the why the plane disappeared. Lost was so good, not because of the mystery, but because of the characters.
Yeah.
That's what makes a good television season. We always get picked on because we troll The Walking Dead. Let me say something positive about The Walking Dead. This season of The Walking Dead, season six, here's not here, the episode about Morgan and kind of the backstory about Morgan about I clear. That was one of the best episodes of The Walking Dead that I've ever seen because it was so character-driven. Walking Dead is at its best when it's a character-driven show, not about who's going to die next. The show now has turned into who's going to die. Is he under that dumpster or is he dead? You know, who got hit over the head? That's the big thing. When you're doing these crazy, like, big reveals and that's your selling point to watch a television series, I think that makes it a bad season. It's always, shows are always at its best when they're exploring the characters that hopefully your audience cares about.
Well, that's why I used to love The Walking Dead. When, is it Lori was the wife?
The wife. Mm-hmm.
When she died, you guys, I kid you not, I cried for like 24 hours straight. Like the next day, randomly throughout my day, I would remember it and start tearing up.
I would love to see Sinead in line at like a Tender Greens. You're like,
Yeah, exactly. It hit me that hard, and that was because I cared about her, and especially her like her family, and that's why I love that show.
Yeah, agreed. All right, last Twitter question.
All right, Terrence tweets, what TV shows do you think are the most overrated? You
said it once when they said about what thing. Big Bang Theory, just dunk in it.
We all know this, Seinfeld. Nah. I think it's super overrated.
Oh, you're an idiot. David?
Oh, it's so hard. There's so many.
Well, give us a bunch of them. I hope they're all, is it Downton Abbey? Say
Downton Abbey is not overrated. There's nothing overrated about anything that Julian Fellows does.
Oh, that was the most British thing you've ever said.
No, I mean, yeah, it would probably be Big Bang Theory. I actually like the first two or three seasons, but after a while, I just don't understand.
Oh,
yeah.
No, I know. What's the most overrated show? 2.5 Men. Why that show existed for as long as it did. Like, I hate everything about that show, especially the theme
song. I honestly,
song.
Like, were upset with my mom and my dad when they liked that show. I was like, I don't want to be in this family anymore. Sinead, you got anything over there?
Overrated, I would say The Walking Dead.
Sinead just
don't hate
crushed.
Me, guys. I
don't
still love
Sinead.
You.
Okay.
I just said something beautiful about The Walking Dead. Just think about that.
Thank you guys for tweeting. Collider TV Talk. Hashtag at Collider TV Talk. We love all of you so, so much. And we love television, especially Seinfeld. And what we also love
is
this week's Pick of the Week.
Yeah.
And the rare Sinead DeVries Pick of the Week.
Take a break from writing your hate comments about my Walking Dead comment. Okay, I'm picking Flight of the Conchords. It ran for 2 seasons on HBO. So Josh was giving me a little bit of insight about this. So basically, it's about Brett and Jermaine, and it started as
they were just a comedy duo.
A comedy duo. See, I always thought that the comedy duo came as a result of the show because the show was this good, but apparently it's the other way around. So Brett and Jermaine moved to New York from New Zealand, and they are like super foreign, and they're basically coming to New York.
Super foreign.
Yeah, it's great. I love when people are really foreign in American cities. It's awesome. Yeah. They come to New York to further their career and look for love, basically. And it's just like a play-by-play of their everyday lives. And it's like semi-improvised, semi-scripted. It's hysterical. There's music. It's like a musical meets like literally just hilarious comedy. It's so good. And they started releasing music with it. I was so obsessed with the show when I watched it. I actually looked up, and they still perform in LA.
Oh, yeah. All the time. Hmm.
Their songs just by themselves are incredible.
Do you know the reason that they didn't do a season 3 and or like 4 or whatever? Because they couldn't, like, they weren't writing enough music.
They weren't writing enough music.
And they didn't want to. They were like, we don't want to rush our music. Their music, like, comes to us. They're like, if we don't have another show, we don't have another show. No problem.
So they perform, like, their biggest hits, like, still on tour today. Bit. Only 2 seasons.
Jermaine.
When you finish season 2, you're going to want a season 3, so prepare for that. But it's really, really good.
Check it out, guys. Flight of the Conchords, you can stream it on the app. It's on demand as well. It's 2 seasons of brilliant TV. Who knew that the New Zealanders, the Kiwis, were that funny? That will do it for us here on Collider TV Talk. Guys, what? What was that? Why are you laughing at me, Sinead? Do you want me to do the fart face again?
I thought that was slightly offensive.
Slightly offensive.
Who knew that New Zealand people were that funny?
Well, we knew the Kiwis from.
I knew you guys.
All we knew the Kiwis from was Lord of the Rings up until. Oh, just shut up, all you guys. I love New Zealand. You're the best. Box. Now I got to write a petition to New Zealand.
Oh,
great.
Oh, boy.
All right, that'll do it for Heroes. I'm Collider TV Talk. I'd like to throw a little RIP to Tyrants. You guys got canceled, but I watched every episode. So thanks for your great, great TV that nobody else watched.
Mrs. Griffin likes that show. Oh, nice. She likes Tyrants.
Me and Mrs. Griff. Before we go, where can the good people find you? Sinead DeVries.
I'm online. Walking Dead fans, I love you. At Sinead DeVries and at thatsosinead.com. Walking Dead fans, I love you. Also here on Mondays, hosting TV Talk, talking about Walking Dead. And on Fridays, hosting Movie Talk. Not really talking about Walking Dead, but still loving it. And hosting Mailbag over the weekend.
David Griffin.
I'm going to be hanging with Sinead all week, talking about my love for The Walking Dead, talking about how I don't troll The Walking Dead, and how I have nothing but love for it, right here at GriffinDE on Twitter and Instagram. And yeah, that's where you can find me.
Sasha Perl-Raver.
I don't read the comments, so you guys can say whatever you want. But if you need to tell me something specific, go to @SashaPerl-Raver on Twitter and Instagram. Otherwise, I'll just be, you know, making homemade bombs with the people who ran my daycare center.
And I'm Josh Macuga at Josh Macuga on Twitter, Instagram, The Josh Macuga Show on YouTube. I'm here every Monday on Collider TV Talk. Guys, tune in Sunday for our post-Emmy reaction show here on Collider. Also, check out all the shows. You got Nightmares. You got Jedi Council. You got Movie Talk. All kinds of great shows that we offer here on Collider. If you're new to the channel, you just clicked on this thing. Check out everything else. As always, here on Collider TV Talk, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.